Good morning, everyone. It's very good to see you all, and may God bless you. And we invite you to join in praise and worshiping of our God. So let's stand up and raise our voice to praise our God. So we'll sing the first hymn, which is Jesus is King. Lord. So let's pray together in Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We'll continue to worship our Lord by him, what a mighty God we serve, and we'll continue to sing, blessed be the name of the Lord, after this hymn.
Thank you.
another hymn is Be Still for the Presence of the Lord. We sing one more hymn before Esther leads us in prayer. It's a new commandment I give unto you.
Thank you.
Please be seated. So I will ask Esther to lead us in prayer.
Good morning, church. Before we pray, excuse me, could I just quickly read two passages of scripture? First one is Philippians 4. just one verse. Verse 6. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. Be anxious for nothing. And the second passage is Hebrews chapter 4, from verse 12. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Amen. Thank you, Father. Almighty God and Heavenly Father, Lord, we give you the praise and we bring our thanks to you today that, Father, through your grace, we can come to a throne that is a throne of grace, and that by your word, we can come to seek you for mercy and grace to help us in every time of need. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for this grace that you have given us. We thank you for the grace of prayer. We thank you, Lord, that we can seek you and find you through this grace. We pray that you would help us, Lord, in our need to pray and not faint in these days, Lord. We pray that you would help us in our need to pray in faith, in the spirit of faith, trusting your word, Lord, that if we ask anything that accords to your will, you have promised to hear us. And if we believe that you hear us, you will give us what we have asked you for. Help us to wait in prayer patiently for you, Father God. Lord, sometimes we don't know what to pray. Lord, may that be our first prayer. Father, we don't know what to pray. Help me to pray. Father, we pray for our children. Lord, we thank you, Father, as we witness your work in their hearts, teaching them to pray. Help their parents, Father, as they teach them to pray to you. Help the little children to know that you hear them, that they have an angel in heaven that always sees your face, that you watch over them, Lord. We pray for the work of power and faith in our children, that, Lord, that they may know you in prayer. Lord God, we pray, Heavenly Father, that as we pray, that we would be listening to the voice of your Holy Spirit, that, Lord, that you would give us the ability to discern between your voice, the voice of your Spirit, and our own thoughts, our own heart, and other people's words that, Lord, are sometimes put into our hearts when we pray. We pray that, Father, that as we pray, you would help us to focus upon you. Lord, help our minds that sometimes drift in prayer to focus upon you, to know whom we have believed and be fully persuaded that you are able to keep that which we have committed unto that day. Lord, what a glorious salvation you've given us. We praise you and thank you and lift up our hearts in gratitude this morning for your Son, the Lord Yeshua. We thank you, Lord, that you are our high priest in heaven. We thank you, Lord, that you can be touched with a feeling for our infirmity. We thank you, Lord, that you know that we are but dust. Lord God, we thank you for your help. We thank you, Lord, that you left your place in glory. You became one of us. You tasted all of our sufferings, and you went to the cross. You laid down your life. Your sinless blood was shed. You died. You redeemed us, Lord, by your blood, and you rose from the dead. Lord, we thank you and praise you that today we serve a risen Savior who is no longer on the cross, but reigning in heaven, that you are the one who is above all power, all principality, every might, every dominion, every name that can be named, not only in this age, but in the age to come. Father God, we pray, fill us with faith as we look to you, our Savior, our God, in these days of darkness, Father God. Let us not be dismayed or distracted by what is going on. But Lord, we pray that you would make your church what you want your church to be, the pillar and ground of truth, a house of prayer where people can come and seek you, Lord. Oh, Father, to that end, we pray that in your mercy you would deliver us, Lord, from these present lockdowns, that, Lord, that you would give mercy to the Johnson government, Father God, that they may know what to do. Lord, to make those decisions that would allow people to return to work and for there to be work for them to return to allow our children to go back to their education. Lord, to take the pressure off the National Health Service. Father God, we pray that, Lord, you would have mercy upon this nation and that, Lord, that in that mercy you would cause your church to rise up and go forward in the power of your Holy Spirit, trusting in the power of your word. Lord God, as they hold out the word of life to a perishing nation. Father, we're about to take the communion. And so, Lord, we'd want to remember the body of Messiah, Lord, on this earth. We pray, Lord, for our brethren who are persecuted for their faith. We pray that you would strengthen them, Father God. We pray that, Lord, that you would pour out your grace upon them. That, Lord, that they would be anxious for nothing, even in the midst of their suffering. Lord, that they would know that they are glorifying you and the glory of your spirit rests upon them as they endure the persecution for your name. Lord, help them to know they're more than conquerors, Lord, that they are victors in you and through you. And Lord, help them to be salt and light, even in their suffering, Father God, that Lord, that you would be glorified and that you would be made known to those, Lord, who have no hope, who have no future, no kingdom, Lord, that you are giving us, Father God. Please strengthen the brethren, strengthen those, Lord, who labor in the word, particularly, Father God. Lord, we just pray that, Lord, that you would glorify yourself in them and through them, Father God. Father God, we pray that, Lord, that just as we sung earlier, that if we have love for one another, people would know that you are our disciples. Father, as we come to your throne of grace now, we ask you, Lord, for mercy and grace to help us in this need. Help us to love one another. Lord, help us to grow in that self-forgetfulness, Lord, that causes our flesh to die and your Holy Spirit to rise up in us, Father God, in these days. We pray that, Lord, that you would make us, Lord, a shining light in the darkness in these days, that you would make us the salt of the earth as you desire us to be. We pray that, Father, that your word, mighty and powerful, would wash us and cleanse us, make us a church without spot and wrinkle, Father God, throughout the earth. For, Lord, this is what you seek according to your word. Father, we pray that, Lord, that as our brother Trevor comes to give your word today, please would you circumcise our ears and our hearts, that we may hear by your spirit and your word. Anoint him, Father God, to bring forth the word in season, Lord, for any who is weary, Lord, whether in this church or, Lord, any who be hearing through the internet. Father, we commit our works to you, and we pray that you would be glorified, Father God, in all that is done in this place. Lord, let us not leave today without having a touch and experience of your Holy Spirit and the power of your word, that we might go out in the confidence of who you are. Thank you, Lord, for all that you will do. For we ask this in the name of the Lord Yeshua. Amen.
Okay, we thank Esther to lead us in prayer. So we'll sing one more hymn before we join the table the Lord prepared for us. So it's "You Laid Aside Your Majesty." So let's stand up and join us in praise and worship of our God. "You Laid Aside Your Majesty." Please be seated. So we'll remember Jesus' death and resurrection by joining his table. But I'd like to read from Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1 to 5, to confess our sins and reflect our lives. So it says, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above it stood seraphim. Each one had six wings, with two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one cried to another and said, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory.' And the post of the door was shaken by the voice of him who cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. So I said, 'Woe is me, for I am undone, because I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.'" I'm from South Korea, where Buddhism used to be main religion, and Buddhism teaches us to reflect your lives and try to be better than who used to be, but it's not enough. We have to stand before God according to this Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1 to 5. And only when we stand before God, who is holy, we will genuinely find how miserable and sinful and filthy we are. We simply can't just reflect and confess our sins. Only when we stand before that holiness and presence of God, we will truly find how sinful we are. And I know you've got your own testimony and also faith. I also have my testimony. When I stood before God of Israel, I truly found how sinful I was and confessed. And began to confess our sins. So we come to his presence at the moment. So before we remember Jesus' death and resurrection, we'll have time, a moment, to reflect our lives and confess our sins before this holy God. Father, we thank you for your existence, and we thank you for your holiness, and we also thank you for shining your light upon us to find how sinful we are, but you have prepared the way for us to be saved through from this filthiness. We therefore want to praise and worship your name because you have sent us your only begotten Son, Jesus, to die for our sins and cleanse us from our sinfulness. It is time to remember this sacrifice of Jesus. We pray that you help us be thankful and also meditate on this amazing sacrifice, that we might be able to face every challenge in this strength. In Jesus' name, amen. Then the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take it, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we thank you for this abundant love Jesus showed us through his death and resurrection. And you proclaim that it is love you have for us, and you express through sacrifice of Jesus. We therefore humbly come before you again to listen to your voice and submit ourselves and cry out to you and be cleansed from our sinfulness. We pray that as you commanded, you also help us grow in faith, that we might grow to be mature and bear good fruit before you. In Jesus' name, amen. He also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Father, we thank you for this cleansing blood of Jesus. We therefore come under this blood again to be purified and also sanctified only through this blood of Jesus. We believe we can be holy and also fulfill your commandment. We also pray that you help us claim the victory Jesus has achieved on the cross against our enemy, that we might be victorious from now with Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. So please hold the cup until everyone gets up, that we'll drink together. So let's remember our Lord, Messiah Jesus. So we'll stand up and sing In Christ Alone, and we will collect the cups when we sing this hymn, In Christ Alone.
Thank you.
praise the Lord. So please be seated. So this is announcements for this coming week, and we welcome you again in the name of Jesus. Whether you are in the hall or in the garden or at home, you are more than welcome. And Trevor, Stewart, Sweet will speak for this Sunday service, and we look forward to hearing from him. And the building and the garden will be closed immediately after service, as we are under lockdown. And please do pray for our nation and the fellowship. And Tony will speak for next Sunday morning service, and it will be in-person service with live streaming online. And please visit our website to check the up-to-date announcement. And we'll have fasting and prayer day this Thursday. So please do decide how you're going to fast. At least one meal, I believe, to be fasted if you want to join. And the meeting will start from 8 p.m. by Zoom on this Thursday. And it is for regular attendees to our service only. And please send an email to blcfoffice@gmail.com to have a link. And the building will be open between 2 and 3:30 p.m. for private prayer on Tuesday and Friday. And if you want to pray, please do come on Tuesday and Friday between 2 and 3:30 p.m. And if you want to give to the Lord, please do so when you come in the basket or with the online. Okay, that's all I've got. And children, junior Sunday school, children can go to low cabin, and I will hand it over to Trevor.
Good morning, everyone. Once again, it's a joy to be here with you in fellowship, both in person and for those online and at home. It's a privilege that we have to worship the Lord, and we're grateful that we can indeed come together and meet in person, albeit socially distanced and with relevant safety precautions taken. Just before I bring God's word this morning, I thought I might just bring a quick update on the Friends of Israel Gospel Ministry. And this is really to celebrate the life of Helena Ostick, who's the oldest member of the Friends of Israel staff, who celebrated her 102nd birthday on Tuesday this week. And I know that Barbara had the privilege of meeting with Helena some years ago. And so Barbara, for you especially, this is just a little homily for Helena, who is the founder of our work in Poland, which began just after the end of World War II. And though she's still a member of staff, Helena is now bedridden. She's almost blind and she's deaf. And she's cared for 24/7 by Anna, who is one of our Polish workers. Helena Ostick is highly regarded by all who work for Friends of Israel, because without Helena, it's likely there would be no Friends of Israel in Poland. Raised by her parents with a love and appreciation for the Jewish people, she knew it was wrong to oppress them. If you knew Helena's story, you would think her unlikely to have been used by the Lord to raise up such a significant group. She was 20 when World War II reached Poland, and she soon found herself helping the Polish resistance by providing first aid to those who fought against Germany. Raised by her parents with a love and appreciation for the Jewish people, she knew it was wrong to oppress them. And after the war ended, Helena and her husband fled to Argentina to avoid the communists who'd taken over Poland and were eliminating anyone connecting with the resistance. Victor Buxbarzen, he was our first chief executive. Victor had met Helena when they were both children in Poland, and he never lost touch with her. And it was Victor who invited her to join the Friends of Israel after she lost her husband to cancer at a young age. God placed on her heart a burden to minister to Jewish people, and with Victor's encouragement, she returned to Poland. That was a very dangerous return for her. And even though she was living under communism, she understood the importance of teaching others to minister. And so she began working with young people, inviting them to go with her on the streets to witness. And she taught them the importance of prayer and encouraged them to obtain a good education in the Bible. That's Helena Ostick. And I praise the Lord for Helena, for her witness to the Jewish people in Poland. And I praise the Lord for this fellowship here and the witness that this fellowship has to the Jewish people in the area and beyond. One other small thing. If you'd like to take part in a conference, the Friends of Israel Gospel Ministry will be holding an online conference from March the 5th until March the 7th. March the 5th is a Friday. There'll be an evening. There'll be two sessions in the evening. And then on the Saturday, March the 6th, there will be sessions in the morning and the afternoon. This is American time, by the way. It will be available to us here to listen to whenever we can. And then on the Sunday, there'll be two sessions in the evening on the 7th. Those sessions will be available to anyone who registers in outside of the USA to just link into whenever you can. And so you can go onto the foi.org website if you'd like to take part and you need to register on there, but it's free. So we welcome you to join us for that conference. It's called Look Up, The Ultimate Ending. See Your Hope-Filled Future Unfold Through the Book of Revelation, and it promises to be an exciting time of study in God's Word. And so we come to the Word this morning. Let's just bow our heads in prayer for a moment. Father, we thank you for all that we've prayed, all that we've sung. We thank you for your Word that's been read. And we thank you, Lord, that when your Word is read, you bless the reading of your Word. And we thank you that your Word is truth, that we can rely on it, that we can come before you, Lord, as sinners saved by grace, as we've just witnessed in the sharing of the bread and the wine. And Father, we pray this morning that you would open all our hearts and open mine too, Lord, as we seek your Word, as we study your Word. Help us to understand all that you say to us through your Word. And may it excite us, Lord. And may it draw us closer to you and want to know more. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Please take your Bibles and open them at Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. And we'll read from verses 6 through 11. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. In verse 8, we read that God demonstrates his love toward us by the fact that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And in John 3:16, that well-known verse, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus' death on the cross is the ultimate proof of God's love. He came to earth to pay the ultimate price for our sins. But can we discover anything more about why Jesus had to come to earth as a man and die a humiliating and painful death? Hebrews chapter 2 gives 8 reasons why this had to happen. And I've been blessed this morning by how many references we've had to Hebrews, both in our prayers, in our hymns, and in our worship. And so I'd like you to turn to chapter 2 with me of Hebrews. And join with me as we explore these reasons in detail. And we begin in Hebrews chapter 2, and we read from verses 5 through to 9a. Hebrews chapter 2, beginning at the 5th verse. For he has not put the world to come, of which we speak, in subjection to angels. Interestingly, as an aside, there was a need to remind these Jewish believers to whom the writer of this letter was addressing that Jesus, in fact, was superior to angels, because there was a cult of angel worship that was prevalent in those days. And so that's why we have that statement. If you read chapter 1 of Hebrews, you'll find that it's explained in great detail. For he's not put the world to come of which we speak in subjection to angels, but one testified in a certain place, saying, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you take care of him? You have made him a little lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, and set him over the works of your hands. You've put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we do not yet see all things put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. In verses 6 through 8, Paul is reminding his readers of Psalm 8. Verse 6 quotes Psalm 8, verse 4. What is man that you are mindful of him? In context, this reads, what is mankind that you remember or think of him? Or perhaps we could put it another way, what is God's divine purpose for mankind? And we find the answer to this question in verses 7 and 8 of our chapter. Verse 7 actually quotes Psalm 8, verse 5. For you have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor. We're reminded that created man is made lower than the angels, both in time and in the order of creation. Verse 8 quotes Psalm 8, verse 6a. You have made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. God originally intended for everything to be put under man's authority. Do you remember what God said to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden in Genesis 1, verse 28? He said, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. And the psalmist David continues in Psalm 8 from verse 6b to verse 8, saying that God has put all things under his or man's feet, all sheep and oxen, even the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea that pass through the paths of the sea. Through Adam, God gave man dominion over the earth. But because of man's sin, this power was taken away. Hebrews 2 verse 8 continues, for in that he, that's God, put all in subjection under him, that's man, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we do not yet see all things put under him, under man. But now we do not yet see all things put under him. The principle of sin leading to death removed the power, but not the right or the authority, to rule. And while sin is still in the world, God's plan and purpose has been delayed. But God's plan and purpose has not been changed. God's plans and purposes are unchanging and unchangeable. And so we can be certain that this will come to pass at some time in the future. And so we can see that God's divine plan for mankind didn't come into being at Christ's first advent, but it will be fulfilled at Christ's second coming, when in Revelation 20, verse 6, we read that all born-again believers will reign over the earth with Christ for 1,000 years. They shall be priests of God and of Christ and shall reign with him 1,000 years. In verse 9a of Hebrews 2, the focus moves from mankind to Jesus. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor. In verse 7, we read that man was made a little lower than the angels, and here we read that Jesus was made a little lower than the angels. But Jesus is the Son of God, the second part of that divine Trinity and co-equal with God the Father. So how can this be? When Jesus came to earth, he took on the position of a man. As a result, he was made a little lower than the angels, and he suffered death on the cross. Unlike Adam, who was disobedient and died as a result of his sin, Jesus was obedient to his Father's will, even unto death. Verse 7 goes on to tell us that Jesus will be crowned with the same glory and honor as man. By becoming flesh and blood and sharing our afflictions, fully identify himself with us, and through his humility and suffering, Jesus defeated the power of death. And this makes it possible for God's promise that mankind will have dominion over the earth to be fulfilled both through Jesus' own dominion and that of the believers who will return to rule and reign with him in the millennium, as we read in Revelation 20, verse 6. If Jesus hadn't taken complete humanity on himself, this would have been impossible. And so the first reason that Jesus came to earth as a man to die is to fulfill God's divine purpose for mankind. The second reason can be found in the second half of verse 9, in Hebrews 2, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. Romans 6, verse 23, tells us that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. The penalty for disobedience to God is spiritual death, the separation of man's soul from God. Now, let me ask you a question. For those of you here and listening online, and I hope it doesn't apply to everyone here, but are you one of those who is spiritually dead? We need to examine our hearts, and are we really believing that the Lord Jesus did die for us? Because before one who is spiritually dead can come to life and be in fellowship with God, there's a price that must be paid. Do you remember what happened in the Garden of Eden after Adam and Eve had sinned? They disobeyed God. They'd eaten from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. They covered their nakedness with fig leaves, but that only partly covered their skin. It wasn't sufficient to cover their sin. And so in Genesis 3, verse 21, we read that God made tunics of skin to clothe them. But in order for this to be possible, the blood of an animal had to be shed. The price to be paid is a blood sacrifice, the price that we remembered in the bread and the wine this morning. Hebrews 9, verse 22 tells us that without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission. The commentator David Guzik says, Adam and Eve were clothed in a garment that was purchased with the life of another. We are clothed with a garment of righteousness that was purchased with the life of another, Jesus Christ. Jesus substituted his life for the life of the unbelieving sinner. But in order to be a substitute, it was necessary for him to be identified with man. And therefore, in order to offer himself as an acceptable sacrifice to God on man's behalf, he had to come to earth in human form. In other words, the very reason Jesus came to earth was that he might die for us, for you, for me. Romans 5, verse 8 tells us that, but God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And so the second reason that Jesus came to earth as a man to die is that he should taste death for everyone. That the Son of Man would give his life for sinners like us is an awesome thought, and perhaps it might prompt us to ask the question, why? And the answer, and indeed the third reason that he came to earth to die, is in verse 10, and it's explained further in verses 11 through 13. In verse 10, we read, it was fitting for him, for whom all things are all things, and by all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. Christ is here described as the captain, or the author of salvation, who is made perfect through his sufferings. That word perfect speaks of his accomplishment, or completion of the divine purpose for which he came. Christ, the sinless Son of God, fulfilled this purpose through his suffering on the cross. Again, it's put quite succinctly by David Guzik. He says, conceivably, God could have engineered a way to save us that did not require the suffering of the Son of God. But it was fitting for Jesus to save us at the cost of his own agony. This is the ultimate illustration of the fact that real love, real giving, involves sacrifice. As David said when Arona offered to give him the threshing floor in 2 Samuel 24, verse 24, he said, no, but I will surely buy it from you for a price, nor will I offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God with that which costs me nothing. We all come before the Lord Jesus at a price that was paid for us. You see, God's love for us had to show itself in sacrifice. And what could God sacrifice unless he added humanity to his deity and suffered on our behalf? It was fitting for the Father to do this. We read this in Isaiah 53, verse 10, where it says that it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. You see, Jesus' death was no circumstance. God had planned this, as prophesied by Isaiah hundreds of years beforehand. And this wasn't Satan's victory, and it wasn't man's victory. This was God's victory. This was God and Jesus, Father and Son, working together. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 19 says, God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. In verse 11 of Hebrews 2, we read that we who are sanctified become one with Christ. For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are all of one. Isn't that a wonderful thought, that we are one with Christ? Through our sanctification, we're all made one with Christ. And the only way that we can all be as one is if we all share the same humanity. We all have that one origin. We're all born of woman. Christ came to earth and became flesh. As we read in John 1, verse 14, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. For this very reason, he's not ashamed to call us his brethren. Jesus could not call us his brethren, however, unless he was human like us. Verse 12 again quotes the Psalms, in this case, Psalm 22, that wonderful messianic psalm which speaks so clearly and eloquently of the crucifixion, the resurrection, and the coming kingdom of Christ. Here he says not only that we are his brethren, but that he will declare your name to my brethren in the midst of the assembly when I sing praise to you. Verse 13 quotes from Isaiah 8, verses 17 and 18. You notice how often the writer to Hebrews is referring to the Hebrew scriptures to remind people of the scriptures that they knew so well. Isaiah 8, verses 17 and 18, verses that foreshadow the Messiah's identification with a people who have been rejected. And I will wait upon the Lord who hides his face from the house of Jacob, and I will hope in him. Here am I and the children whom the Lord has given me. We are for signs and wonders in Israel from the Lord of hosts who dwells in Mount Zion. And we can see those words reflected in the Lord's Prayer, which we find in John 17, verses 6 through 8. I always feel that the real Lord's Prayer is in John 17. And in those verses we read, I have manifested your name to the men whom you have given me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they have known that all things which you have given me are from you. For I have given them the words which you have given me, and they have received them and have known surely that I came forth from you, and they have believed that you sent me. And I trust that we've all received those words too and believe that Jesus is the one whom God sent. Christ so identified himself with mankind that he desires to look upon those who are born again as his brethren. Christ is united to us as we are united to him. We are spiritually one. The fact that he calls us his brethren means that we and the Son of God share the same humanity and belong to the same family. Those of us who were born again worship him, we adore him, we follow him, we hold fast to his every word, and he shares everything he has with us, even his glory. But if we look at the world today, everything seems to revolve around so-called celebrities, those who've made a rich living out of their looks or their abilities to act in some unholy film or play or be some influencer on YouTube or Instagram. They're also worshipped and adored and followed, and people believe everything they say. But would those celebrities share their fame, their glory, and everything they have with their followers? Would they humble themselves to the point of suffering and death for their followers? You see, brothers and sisters, there's an ever-widening chasm between the Word of God and the world. I always like to say that the English language gives us some wonderful little pictures. If we look at word and world, there's only one letter, and that letter is L. Oh, and I dropped my H. One letter difference between world and word. It's easy, isn't it, brothers and sisters, for us all to be caught up in worldly values. But our focus must be on word values and not world values. And that's a challenge to all of us, isn't it? When we look at ourselves, when we examine ourselves, where are we placing that value, that worth? Is it in worldly values or word values? God's words, values. God's values indeed. And so in verses 10 to 13, the third reason that Jesus came to earth as a man to die was to bring many sons to glory. We see the fourth reason in verse 14. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil. Christ came to partake of flesh and blood, to become a mortal human being like us. He did this so that on our behalf he might destroy him who had the power of death, the devil. Satan is the only one who can separate man's soul from God through spiritual death. Jesus' death brought divine judgment on Satan, sentencing him to be bound for a thousand years, as we read in Revelation 20, verses 2 and 3, and in finally consigning him to an eternity of torment in the lake of fire, as we read in Revelation 20, verse 10. It's interesting that it's an eternity of torment, which means that there's no death in hell, not physical death, only torment. It was at the cross that Jesus fought with Satan in order to break his power. And it was in the ninth hour during those final few moments when he cried out in agony. Do you remember those words? Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? When Jesus took upon himself the sins of the whole world, he was momentarily separated from his Father. And when we consider what that agony of separation really meant, and only when we consider what that agony of separation really meant can we begin to realize and understand the true cost of the sacrifice that Jesus made at Calvary. And it's worth pausing again for a moment just to consider the question, on whose territory are we living? Are we living on God's territory, or are we living in Satan's territory? If you remember, Satan is the prince of the power of the air and the ruler of this world. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4 tells us that he's the god of this world who has blinded the minds of them who do not believe. And it's because of this that the world system and world views are so much in opposition to God and his word, and why we, as Christians, are destined to trials, tribulation, and persecution. And Esther prayed today, didn't she, for the persecuted among us, our brothers and sisters in countries where they're being persecuted. And we can see signs beginning that it may not be too long before we here in England and the United Kingdom might also be affected by that same persecution. We're living in an increasingly godless society. But take a look, close look at what Scripture points us toward. One day, Christ will come to take his church to be with himself. At that time, we call the rapture. And then one day we will return with him as victors to rule and reign with him. And the wonderful hope we have there is not only are we going to be with Christ for eternity and come back with him to reign when he returns, it tells us that Christ is coming back. He will return. And that's a certainty that we have, that Christ will return. And so the fourth reason that Jesus came to earth as a man to die was in order to destroy Satan's rule over humanity. And that brings us to the fifth reason in verse 15. Christ came to release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Through his death, Jesus made it possible for mankind to be delivered from bondage to the fear of death. If you ask any non-believer what they fear most, you'll probably get the answer, that they fear death. Fear of the unknown is uppermost in many, if not most, people's minds. And we need to be careful, don't we, that we don't fall prey to the fear of the unknown, especially in these days. The unsaved have no hope, except that they might just disappear into oblivion and know nothing more, called annihilationism. or as some teach, to return as a lion, a spider, or a worm, reincarnation. But where's your hope? Where's my hope? We see in Romans 8, verse 1, that for the believer there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk after the flesh and not after the Spirit. There is no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. Jesus gives us a wonderful promise of assurance in John 5, verse 24, where he says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life." The Apostle John gives an even more emphatic assurance of everlasting life when he says of believers in John 10, verse 28, "They shall never perish." And you've probably heard me say this before, but the English translation doesn't give us the true emphasis that we see in the original Greek to that word never. In the Greek, it's a double negative. It's oumi, meaning not ever, ever, ever. But in John 10, verse 28, it's followed by the Greek word aeon, meaning forever, for eternity, without end. You see, we have a promise which is without end, an eternal promise. Our salvation, in short, is assured. We can have no doubt when we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ that we are saved and we are saved for eternity. Nothing can snatch us out of God's hands. 1 Corinthians 15, 55 asks, "O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory?" When we walk in the Spirit of God and not in the flesh, we should know the answer to that question because it's in the following two verses of 1 Corinthians 15. "The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." We have that victory. Brothers and sisters, because of Christ's victory, we share that victory. We have overcome. And a question again is, do you share that promise of assurance? Do you know that victory in your heart? Are you certain of your salvation, of an eternity with the Lord? The fifth reason Jesus came to earth as a man to die is to free those who are in bondage to the fear of death. In verses 16 and 17a, we see the sixth reason. "For indeed he does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. Therefore in all things he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God." And I thank the Lord that Esther reminded of that when she read from Hebrews in our time of prayer this morning. Jesus came to be a merciful and faithful high priest. But why is this significant? What's the role of a priest? A priest must identify with the people he represents. And again, for Jesus to do this, it was necessary for him to take on flesh, to become one of us, to be made like unto his brethren. Jesus didn't take on the nature of an angel. He took on the nature of the seed of Abraham. He took on human nature and human flesh as a man. And because of this, Christ can identify with us in our sufferings. You see, a priest acts as a mediator between man and God. He represents man before God. He intercedes before God on behalf of the people. And we read in Hebrews 7:25 that he, Jesus, is able also to save them to the uttermost that came unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Isn't that a wonderful thought that Jesus is there at God's right hand, interceding for you and for me, 24/7, non-stop. And in Hebrews 6, verse 20, and 7, verse 17, and in Hebrews 7, verse 21, we read that Jesus is a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. In other words, unlike earthly priests who died and needed to be replaced, his priesthood is for eternity. He is forever interceding for us. And so the sixth reason that Jesus came to earth as a man to die is to become a merciful and faithful high priest to mankind for eternity. The seventh reason that God, the Son of God, became man and had to die is in verse 17b. He came to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. 1 John 2 verse 2 tells us that he's the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for also for the sins of the whole world. Jesus didn't just come to die for those who would come to believe in him. He came to die for everyone, for all of mankind. All mankind has that opportunity for their sins to be forgiven, to have that relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Christ is the propitiation for our sins. In other words, he appeased God by becoming our sacrifice and shedding his own blood, and not just for our sins, but for the sins of the world. For Jewish people today, this would remind them of the most significant day in their calendar, the Day of Atonement, or Yom Kippur. That day when the high priest, after cleansing himself and offering a sacrifice for his own sin, entered into the very presence of God. Covered by clouds of smoke from the burning coals on the altar of incense, the priest stood before God on behalf of a guilty people and sprinkled the blood of the sin offering on the mercy seat in the Holy of Holies. If you remember, the mercy seat was the cover of the Ark of the Covenant that was placed in the Holy of Holies. He effectively sprinkled the sacrificial blood over the broken law. In other words, he was covering the sins of the people. But that sacrifice was a substitutionary death for a guilty people. And in God's eyes, the penalty of the law for sin had been paid. And by this act, their sins were forgiven. And if you remember, the nation's sin was then confessed over the head of the scapegoat. And the scapegoat was led to the wilderness, symbolically removing their sin. The price for sin had been paid. Their sin had symbolically been removed. But unlike the scapegoat of the Old Testament, Jesus not only symbolically removed our sins, he completely removed our sins. Isn't that wonderful? Completely removed our sins. He took those sins upon himself on that cross at Calvary, bearing not only our sins, as we've said already, but those of mankind. But he didn't just bear those sins. He paid the penalty. The penalty of death in full. Through his selfless act and shed blood, we have been reconciled to God. Hallelujah. Christ, by his death on the cross, provided propitiation of our sin. He reconciled us to God. And as we read in Psalm 103, verse 12, as far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. And so the seventh reason that Jesus came to earth as a man to die is to reconcile us to God. And the eighth and final reason we find in verse 18, for in that he himself hath suffered being tempted, he is able to help them that are tempted. God can't be tempted, can he? We read that in James 1:13. God can't be put to the test, can he? We read that in Deuteronomy 6, verse 16 and Matthew 4, verse 7. And yet Jesus was both tempted and put to the test. The Son of God was both tempted and put to the test. And for that to happen, he had to become flesh and blood. Then, and only then, not only could Jesus be tempted, but he could fully identify with us in our temptations and trials. Now, that doesn't mean to say that Jesus identifies himself with our sin, because he is the sinless Son of God, isn't he? On the Mount of Temptation, Satan tempted Jesus to break the law. Jesus' temptation came from without. It came from Satan. But our temptation comes from within us. It comes from that sin nature that's inherent in every single one of us. However, because Christ understands the nature of temptation, he can identify with us when we are tempted. And it's worth remembering that Jesus, whilst not having a fallen sin nature, Jesus actually lived in a corruptible body. And therefore, he was subject to the same sufferings that we are. As a result, Christ is a sympathetic, compassionate, merciful, and faithful high priest. But his sympathy is related to our suffering and not our sin. We're constantly being tempted, aren't we? We're constantly being buffeted by the world's values. And submission to sin is waiting around every corner for each and every one of us. And if we're not watchful, we will succumb. Cast your eyes on Jesus. Keep our eyes on Jesus, the author, the perfecter, the finisher of our faith. Run that race with perseverance is what we're told to do, isn't it? If it's great comfort, isn't it, to know that we have that advocate in heaven, Jesus, who understands our weaknesses and is able to help us in our hour of need. And so the eighth reason and the final reason why Jesus came to earth as a man to die was to help us in our temptations, in our testings. And so, brothers and sisters, we've seen eight reasons why Jesus had to come to earth as a man and die. And as we draw to a close, let's remind ourselves of what those eight reasons are. The first one, to fulfill God's purpose for man in Hebrews 2, verses 5 through 9a. The second, to taste death for all in verse 9b. In verses 10 through 13, we read that it's to bring many sons to glory, and in 14, to destroy the devil. The fifth reason, to deliver those in bondage in verse 15. And the sixth reason, to become a priest for mankind, all mankind, in verse 16 to 17a. In verse 7, it was to make reconciliation for our sins in 17b. And finally, in verse 18, we had the eighth reason, to provide help for those who are tested. Knowing Christ as Saviour, however, requires us to obey him and to continually submit to his will and not our own. Through the shed blood of Christ on the cross, our sins have been forgiven, and we can come into the presence of a holy God. And what's more, for those who are truly born again, there's that blessed assurance of the promise of eternal life. In John 10, verse 28, I give to them eternal life, and they shall never, ever, 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 ever perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Brothers and sisters, we need to take hold of that promise. We need to take hold of what Jesus did for us and what Jesus is indeed doing for us. In John 14, 6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. There is no other way to the Lord, only through Jesus. The world tries to tell us that there are many ways to God, but there is only one way. And Acts 4:12 tells us that neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other, no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. The only person that can save us from all that's going on, from this world of trouble, from this world of sin, and from our own sin, is the Lord Jesus Christ. And he can only do that because of the price he paid with his own body on the cross at Calvary. We've discovered eight reasons why Jesus had to come to earth as a man and die. But again, let me ask you the question, are you someone who fears death? The Apostle Paul had no fear of death. He said in Philippians 1, verse 21, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. And why did he say that? Because if he was living on this earth, he could had the opportunity to share the gospel. That was to live is Christ. But to die is gain? Well, Paul knew, as all of us should also know if we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that our gain is a life in eternity, in a world without sin, without death, without sorrow, without suffering, without crying, without tears. That's the promise that we have been given. That's the hope that we have. Are you secure in the knowledge that you are in Christ Jesus? Or have you yet to believe in his death and resurrection and cry out to him to save you? I urge anyone who's in that position that has yet to call out on the name of Jesus to do that today, because we're living in a world of increasing fear and anxiety and doubt, and only Jesus can take that away. May the Lord seal his eternal word in our hearts, and to him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. I'll ask you on to bring the service to a close.
Okay, we thank Trevor for sharing the word of God with us. Okay, we'll sing the final hymn before we close our service. So let's stand up and join us. Praise and worship of our God is Jesus paid it all. Let's pray. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat. Father, we thank you for this testimony you have given us through Jesus the Messiah. We pray that you help us stick with this faith and also hold on to this faith to be saved, that we might also confess that Jesus perfected our soul well. As we depart, we pray for your blessing, protection, guidance, boldness, and breaking through, that we might face every challenge or difficulty in your strength. We also pray for our brothers and sisters who are not well or face some challenges or working as key workers. We pray especially for them that they might be strengthened by your strength. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, thank you for joining us, and may God bless you all.
I'm a new creation. D. I am a new creation. Known as a child hymn, but because Tony is preaching Exodus,